noise right now. Let me hear it. Come on, Zion, clap those hands with me. Come on, come on, all God's people. Come on, come on, Mike. Do them up like this, do them up like this, come on. Here we go, let's go. You're welcome at Grace. Find love at Grace. Spread peace at Grace. Find joy at Grace. Said you're welcome here. All are welcome here. We welcome you to Grace Congregational.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. My prayer today is only two words. Remember me. On this day, we celebrate the life, the resurrection, and the ascension of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us love, serve, remember, and exalt his name, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to Grace Congregational Church of Harlem. We welcome you to this sacred space and this sacred place. I almost feel like I need to kick off my shoes because I feel like we are on holy ground. Amen. This week, as we honor and celebrate our families, but we also give thanks to, for all that we have received and all that we have been given. And so we make sure this week that we are grateful for that which we have been given. And we have been given life and liberty and all that God has for us. And so we say thankfully this week, we say thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We also acknowledge that this week is also a day of national mourning, a day of national atonement for the Native Americans, the indigenous people who suffered much because of those who came here and hurt and killed and maimed their families. And so that is a day to acknowledge them and what has happened to them as a people by this country. So moving on, we have also to recognize the Reverend Dr. William Carey, who was a pastor here at Grace Congregational Church in the 60s. He was also the first black pastor of the National Council of Churches, which was the largest organization. And he was an advocate for black power. And during the civil rights movement, he died last Sunday in his home at 94. And so our honor goes to him for the pastoring that he did, but also for the leadership that he did as well. He is survived by his wife and his daughter, and so our prayers go out to his family, as he has certainly contributed to the great legacy of this church, and we thank him for that. Amen. This week, as we watch the closing arguments of the Kyle Rittenhouse, and we're watching the trial of Ahmaud Arbery, there was an article in the New York Times that said, what if the individuals were switched? What if it were Ahmaud Arbery who was walking down the street with an AR-15 and shot two people? Would he have gotten off? And if Kyle Rittenhouse was running through a neighborhood and looked into a new house, would he have gotten shot? And so we know the answer to those questions, and we know at the core of that is what's wrong with America, that racism still is deeply seated in this country. And so we pray that those things will be corrected over time and that we will find justice in this world and in this place. We also say our prayers for those who are suffering in this moment, in the pandemic, and going through it. We've lost over 750,000 lives. And also this week, we hit a new milestone in the opioid crisis. Over 100,000 people have died due to overdose in opioids. And so we know that this is a difficult time for many people, and so we want to make sure that we reach out to the hurting and those who are in pain, because turning to other things like drugs will only deepen and worsen the pain. And so our love and our hearts go out to all who are suffering in this season. Enjoy today's service, and today we have afterwards, we'll have a gathering to eat together and spend time together and fellowship. God bless you, and thank you for being here this morning. Amen.
God knows the plans he has for me. He knows the thoughts he thinks towards me. And nothing is an accident. I'm alive because there's more. God knows the plans he has for me. He knows the thoughts he thinks towards me. And nothing is an accident. I'm alive because there's more. I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive. And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more.
Come on, if you believe that, help us out. God knows the plans.
God knows the plans
he has for me.
He has for me.
He knows the thoughts
he thinks towards me. And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more.
God knows the plans.
God knows the plans
he has for me.
He has for me.
He knows the thoughts he thinks towards me. And nothing is an accident. I'm alive because there's more.
I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive. And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more. I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive. And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more. He didn't let me die, let me die, let me die, let me die. An accident. I'm alive because there's more.
He didn't let me die.
He didn't let me die. Oh, let me die.
Let me die. Let me die.
And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more.
This is not the end.
Not the end, not the end, not the end. And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more.
There is more.
There is more. There is more. There is more. There is more. And this is not an accident. I'm alive because there's more. And I am not an accident. I'm alive because there's more. And I am not an accident. I'm alive because there's more.
Amen, amen, amen. We have been following the book of Genesis and all the way from the beginning of creation to Adam and Eve and Cain, and then we got to Noah and the rainbow. I skipped over the Tower of Babel because I did talk about the Tower of Babel in a city that people tried to make a name for themselves and use and do it without God. But I bring you to chapter 12 of Genesis, where it's the beginning of Abram's walk. He's not yet Abraham, It's the beginning of his ministry, because in chapter 11, his father and brother have died, and he has now been told by God to get out, to leave his homeland and his country, and to go to a place unknown. And this is how ministry starts, and this is how we are to begin and to think about the beginning of a new year and a new life in ministry. I'll read from you Genesis 12, 1 to 4. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, your father's household, to a land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great. And I will bless, and you will be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all people on this earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went to the Lord, and he told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out for Haran. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your love and for your understanding. We ask now that you send down all that you are and all that you have so that we may know and get a glimpse of your glory, so that we may see a piece of you. We thank you, Lord God. Let all that we say and all that we do edify you in each and every way. Amen. Whenever we meet God face to face, whenever we have an encounter with God face to face, it automatically says, get out. It automatically sends us. We have to get out of the familiar, get out of the place of comfort, get out of our homeland, get out of our father's house, get to places unknown. Abram was stuck. He was on his way to the land of Canaan, the promised land, and he loved his father so much, and his father, whose name is Terah, whose name meant stuck, he was following a man whose name was stuck. And so he was stuck in the land of Haran. It wasn't until his father died and he had lost his brother that God said, get out. It was time to move on and to carry out the mission that they were supposed to be on. And so here he is in a terrible moment, in a place we call the curb, where there's no more past and you don't know what the future looks like. And so you're in that place in the curve of your life when you don't know what will happen in front of you, and you don't see clearly what has happened behind you. And this is where Abram finds himself, 75 years old. He is 75 years old. And his name, Abram, just so you know, his name means exalted father. He is 75 years old and he has no children. And yet God is saying, and God places this great promise that through him, all nations will be blessed and his name will be great. As you know, Jesus mentions his name, for he says, before Abram, I was. And so that is the beginning. That is the beginning of ministry. And when you understand that you have an encounter with God, it changes you and turns you into a missionary. Missionary, which means one who is sent, one who goes out in the name of God. And so Abram is now sent out to do what God has called him to do, to take a great risk, to make a great move, and to get out. I understand many people feel this may, well, this was Abraham. This was the great Abraham. Of course he had to do a great thing and a great move. But that is a call for all of us to get out of our familiar space, to get out of the things that we do normally and routinely and get into a space where we can do something for God. And it only happens in the wilderness. It only happens in the place of unknown. Like Moses. Moses was the one who listened to God, deferred to God, and bowed to God. And the first time he meets God, God tells him to go and speak to Pharaoh and tell him about the great I am. And he grasps the grandeur of God. He grasps the holiness of God. And he is sent into the lion's den. He is sent into the seat of power to speak on God's behalf. And so we see how many times in the Bible how people are sent out. For when Peter and them were fishing, and Jesus said, and they had been fishing all night, And they came back in with empty nets. And Jesus said, go back out one more time and cast your nets out on the right side. And they said, we've been fishing all night. But they went back out, and they'd almost broke all their nets to catch what he had for them. And he said, I will make you fishers of men. And so ministry and what God is calling us to do is to go out, to get a glimpse of glory, to see what God can do in our lives when we trust and obey him and hear his voice. And we end up listening to him and doing the things that he needs us to do. For he comes to see the Lord. And even Isaiah, which is a great prophet, we see how he sees the Lord. He sees the Lord who's lifted up and overwhelms him. And it drives him to his knees. And he sees the glory and the grandeur of God himself. And so in these cases, it changes us to go out. Because he tells Isaiah, I have a mission for you. I have a job for you. I want you to go out and speak to the people. Speak to them. Preach to them. They will not listen. There are hard-hearted people. But I want you to do it anyway. And you will do it for years and years and years. And nobody will listen to you. Nobody will take heed. But he says, and of course Isaiah responds, here I am. Send me. Here I am. Send me. And so we lose our sense of consumer mentality. This is all for me. This is all for me. And this is all I do. It's all the blessings that I receive are for me. Because we understand that if we are blessed, it is only to be blessed so that we can be a blessing to others. And that is why God is giving us what we have so that we can be a blessing to others. To take the risk. To take the sacrifice and say, I will go and I will do what I am told as God has given me the gifts and the talents and the treasures to be a blessing to others. We ought to think about this on this week. When we're thinking about gratitude, how do we show our gratitude but to give that which has been given to us and to meet the people's needs in the name of Christ? To meet people's needs in the name of Christ. Maybe you say the prophets were different. Maybe you say the prophets were extraordinary. But I'm here to say this morning, we are the current prophets here on earth at this moment to do God's work. And so the epic people like Abraham and Moses and Isaiah and Peter all show us emblematically what we are to do. The vision, the fire to the fishes, the burning bush. This is all. For God only blesses us in order to bless us. God will never bless us unless he wants us to be a blessing to other people. And so he will bless you. And you heard that in the reading of the text, that God will bless you and has a great name, and your name will be great. God never pulls us in unless he sends us out. And so he is sending us out to be the missionaries in this world, to help those who are in need. And that is how dealing with the real God. You know you're dealing with the real God when you are being sent out to do something that is unfamiliar, that is uncomfortable for you, to do the thing which you would have never done on your own. That is when we become the men and the women who are on mission for God, because God is calling us this morning to do something different, to do something extraordinary. And Abraham and Moses and Peter, they show us who this is. This is to do. And this happens to people all the time. Blaise Pascal, mathematical genius, inventor. In fact, he's the grandfather of the computer, the philosopher, the theologian. He had an experience one night, a near-death experience with a carriage, and he spent from 10:30 to 12:30 with God. And he had one word to say, fire. Fire. Because he had that experience with God. It said the God of Abraham and God of Isaac and God of Jacob, not the God of philosophers, but certainly, heartfelt joy and peace came over him as he recognized the Jesus Christ, the God of our God. The God of our God. The world has forgotten him, but just look into the Gospels. You will see the greatness of the human soul, the greatness of the Father of the world. And at the end of that, he writes, tears, 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 joy, tears of joy. And so we know that there is a great joy that can come over us when we are following what God has called us to do. God is calling us to do, and God calls his people. That is what church is. It is sending out God's people who are called by him to go out into this world. For you remember in John 17:18, Jesus says, as you sent me into this world, Father, I am sending them into this world. As you sent me into this world, Father, I am sending them into this world. And so I'm telling you these things because it is the fullness of joy. Nobody has joy like somebody has something that knows it's going to change the world if I release what God has put in me. Nobody has joy than somebody who knows there's something bigger than their own interest. Nobody has joy than somebody who has in their heart more than their own career advancement, more than their own self, more than their own love, more than their own hurts, or more than their own aches and pains. And nobody had joy like Jesus Christ, because he was the one who was on mission from the day he set foot on this planet. He was on fire for us, for he knew why he was sent, and he knew what he had to accomplish, and he did. And on the cross he said, it is finished. It is for our lives to do and to go out and to lose this consumer mentality. I know Black Friday is coming. I know Cyber Monday is coming. But guess what comes right after that? And that's Giving Tuesday. We ought to be thinking about Giving Tuesday, about how do we give to this world? How do we become givers in this world and not just consumers? Because we have been taking and taking, and we see the destruction of our planet. We see the destruction of our economy. We see the destruction of this world. And if we continue to keep taking, we will see the destruction of everything. And so this morning, we have to stop saying, what's in it for me? And this morning, we have to say, what can I do and help this world? Rather than just spending it on me, what can I do to help this world? And so number one, God never blesses us unless we are to be a blessing to others. We're to take our blessings and use them for the benefit of others. But the second thing is that it will cost you something. It will cost you dearly to be in ministry. It has to cost you something because it takes you to a new place that you would have never gone. Abraham is blessing the world, and Abraham's mission is to leave and to get out. The first thing God says to him is to get out of your country, get out of your kingdom, get out of your father's house. Get out, because this is the beginning of your ministry and your walk. And he has, and here, and many of us who entered ministry, it may upset your family that you have left. I remember when I left the Catholic Church, my parents were like, you're no longer Christian. How come you're doing this? Why are you doing this? What are you doing in that Pentecostal church? That's not real church. I remember those days. And then when I said I was going to become a pastor, they thought, well, where's your pension? How are you going to take care of yourself? And they were concerned for me. Because when you leave the familiar and go to the unknown, there are going to be people who are going to be concerned for you. There are going to be people who ridicule you. What are you doing that for? I remember pastors saying, what are you leaving Wall Street to become a pastor for? I remember those conversations. Because you have to understand, when God has called you to do something, it takes you out of a place that you would normally would have gone to a place you never would have gone to. And so when you realize, when you meet Jesus, you realize there's no such thing as Catholic and Episcopal and Baptist and Pentecostal and Methodist, because you've met Christ. And those titles don't mean anything to God. Because if God is God all by himself, and we have to recognize this morning, there is no particular denomination, but there is only Jesus Christ. And that is what we believe, and that is what changes us to do, to stand up for who we are and who we created to be, and to go out into this world. And so when we're doing church, it is the hardest thing. We are trying all to restart church and to figure this thing out. And whether we go live or whether we go virtual or whether we have to do a hybrid, how do we get this thing so that people are still getting the message of God and still going out into this world and doing the thing that God has called them to do? How do we get out? How do we get out of our jobs, get out of our careers, get out of our place of security, and go to the place that God has called us? Last week when I preached, a young man came up to me afterwards and he said, thank you
going to go back into corporate America. But I realized there's more to do with my life, and I can help people in many different ways. And I'm not going back to corporate America, but I'm going to help people in a nonprofit world. And sometimes we have to hear the message of God and be transformed by it. So to know that we have something to offer, because then when you get to church, they're like, what budget? There ain't no budget. What money? There ain't no money. There ain't nothing. And yet you have to figure out how to make this work. How to make this work for God. How to create a space for God. Because you have given up your safety. You have given up all the things you thought you needed to have in order to do ministry. So this morning we have to get out. We have to leave friendships behind. We have to leave family behind. Sometimes we have to work around the clock. Sometimes there is no financial remuneration. Sometimes we just have to give our whole heart to all that we're doing and bless others with it. And so the cost is dear. The cost is dear. It will risk everything. It will risk being ridiculed and joked about. It'll risk everything to you. Your family, your home, everything. Your reputation, your status. That is what missionaries do. They give up everything. I remember those that went to Africa and they couldn't get out because they were afraid to leave the camp. And they remembered three things. What if we don't do it? Who will do it? And what if we don't do it now? When will it get done? And if this doesn't happen, how will it ever happen? And we have to ask ourselves, who will do it if we don't do it? And when will it get done if it's not now? When is the time? It is the time is now. It is critical that we work hard to get the message of God, the message of Jesus Christ out into this world. If you've been listening to anything that I've said in the past, we know it ought to be transforming. You can't just come to church every Sunday and hear a sermon. That's not going to transform you. What transforms you is when you go out, get out of your space, and go out into this world and see and connect with the suffering of this world and the pain in this world, and then you recognize, I have to do something about it. I have to change that. And so we understand that, number one, we understand that we have to go out. We have to get out of our space. Number two, it's going to cost us something. But number three, in sending out and blessing us, we know that God particularly has a promise over our life. God has a promise over our life, where he says to Abram, I will make you great, and I will make your name great, for you will go out. And the people who put their life on the line, the people who had to do those things, they have a sense and understanding of why God has given them and the precious mantle they hold, for they are to go out into this world and change this world. This is, because as you recall, when did Jesus get blessed? You remember that when the dove descended on him, and he knew that he was a son of God. And it said, God said, this is my son, my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. It is that moment when he began his ministry and started. And some say, well, why did Jesus have to be baptized? He was baptized to show the renewing strength and the beginning of a new ministry. The new ministry that he had begun when he started, when he came up out of that water, and he knew with the assurance that he was a child of God. And that is what you need to know, is when you meet God, you are a child of the living King, and you have a precious gift inside of you. And so you're seeing growth in your life. You're seeing understanding in your life. You're recognizing, I'm a child of God, and nothing can take that away from you, because that's the name you want to know. That's the name you want to go by. Remember, Abram, he understood his name meant exalted father. He had no children. He was 75 years old already and no children. And yet his name, everybody called him by that name, reminded him of who he is and who God had made him to be. And so I hope this morning you recognize your name. You recognize who God calls you by, and you recognize your mission and your purpose. Because these are the things that we have to understand. The commendation of a loving Father who has sent us out into this world. We cannot forget our name. And so we must break loose from the things that don't matter anymore. We have to break loose from the things that have been holding us back. Abraham loved his father. Abraham was sticking with his father, and a man whose name meant going nowhere. But he stuck with him and loved him. But it wasn't until he died was he able to get out and go and do what God told him to do. And so this morning, we have to think about, why are we not getting out there? Why? What's holding us back? What's keeping us from the mission that God has given us? What's holding you back? And once you have this assurance, once you have this understanding, God says you ought to know you're a man or a woman on a mission. And God has called you and called you out to do the thing that God is calling you to do this morning. So I want you to be a blessing to others. I want you to think about all the things that you've been given. And why have you been given them? To go out and to give them to this world. And this is our message for you this morning. Because we have to be willing to go out. Howard Thurman used to do this at the end of his sermons, and some say it was attributed to him. I don't think he wrote it, but I think he said it so often that many people thought he did. But he said, I'm tired of sailing my boat, my little boat, from the inside of the harbor. I want to go out where the big ships are. I want to go out where the great ones are. And should my frail little craft prove to be so slight for the waves, the sweep of the bellows over, I'd rather go down in a stirring fight than drown to death at the sheltered shore. I want to go out where the big boats are. I want you to go out where the big boats are. Amen.
Be where you are. Father God, we come to you at this moment with gratitude in our hearts for all that you have done for us. And how can we repay you when you have given us everything and sacrificed all for us? And so, Lord God, it is only with a heart of thanksgiving that we give back to you. And so, God bless you. God bless you in your giving. Amen.
I was here when I got here.
Just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. One more. Just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me.
Gracious God, we thank you for these gifts. We thank you for your hand of love that has bestowed upon us life and all there is within it. We thank you for moving heaven and earth for us so that you could show us how much you love us. May these gifts be used to spread your love and that your house will be full. Amen. May the grace of God and the sweetest communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide in every household of faith, now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, Grace Church said, amen. Go and love and serve the Lord. Amen.